worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds a victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout at the praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout at the praise. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way.
Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out the praise.
Oh, we shout out the praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven.
Forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise.
That are willing to teach and to help us learn about you and try to just grow as Christians so that we can help folks who need you in that community. We pray that you be with us as we go through the service, be with the songs that we sing, be with the word that is preached. We just pray that you would soften hearts and just give people a longing and a want to make a change if that's what needs to happen. And we just pray that you would go with us through the rest of this day and help me to do what you'd have me do. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, you may be seated. I want to welcome all our guests we had today. Thank you for being here. Like Brian said, just thankful for a great Sunday school hour. Our classroom is full. I know some of the other classrooms downstairs have a little more people in it, so that's always good. New faces and everybody's original faces are all here. So thankful for that. Announcement-wise, only thing I have is homecoming festivities this week, next weekend. We're doing the fish fry. Not auction, just a fish fry next Saturday at 6 p.m. Have any questions or anyone want to help, see Miss Chrissy. She'll get you heading the right direction. Anything you want to talk, announce about that?
Or? These people that want to help with the fish fry, probably about 4 o'clock. Okay.
All right, so people helping cook and do the fish fry portion of it, be here around 4.
I have flyers if anybody wants one.
Flyers, Miss Ashley has flyers to pass those out to advertise it. Next Sunday morning, we'll have our homecoming service with music and then a meal, fellowship meal afterwards. Lisa said, church providing the meat, everybody else provide the sides, so bring your favorite dishes, bring multiple favorite dishes and some desserts, and we'll be set just fine. Anything else that needs to be announced according to that?
So two things to remind you of. Tonight we're going to be, tonight we're going to be sharing our story. We've been talking about outreach and evangelism for weeks, and we've been doing some training. Tonight we're going to be sharing our story. So come back tonight. This is something that you need to learn how to do, but you need to practice being open and telling what Christ has done for you. And we're going to have a great time of fellowship as we're doing this. We'll meet over in the fellowship hall, and we'll practice sharing our story with each other to get us ready to go out next week and the following weeks to invite people to the fish fry and the auction. And, oh, by the way, let me tell you what Jesus did. And we have all types of opportunities. And I'm going to be preaching about that, so I don't want to say too much. But be here tonight. I think you'll get a blessing out of that. And then don't forget, October 16th, Sunday night, it's going to be at Portland General Baptist Church. That'll be the first night of an association-wide revival. It's going to go for 2 weeks. The first night is Union Chapel night. So I'm going to be preaching there. The praise team's going to be singing. And we're going to dismiss our service to go over there. I want to encourage you to attend. This is an opportunity that we don't get to have very much, to have activities with all the churches in our association. So don't miss that Sunday night, October 16th. It'll be at 6 o'clock. Right? No, 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock on Sunday night at Portland General Baptist. We're going to be saying more about that. So just be praying and getting all set for revival. We're going to get to experience some great things. So.
Great. All right. How many of you ladies feel like that your life is just really full? Full of stuff, full of busyness. You've got too many places to go, too much to do, too many things in the fire kind of thing. We're going to be starting a Bible study here. It's going to be coming up beginning October 12th on Wednesday nights from 6 to 7. We're going to be digging into the Word, and we're going to be doing a Bible study from Priscilla Shire, and it's called Breathe. And it's about this busyness that we all have a tendency of getting ourselves into, and getting us to look at stopping and breathing and just letting God take away some of the things that we need to let go of, some things in life. We got a video clip we're going to show real quick about this. So, Russ, can you hit the lights back there? And Becky, go ahead and hit the video.
Have you ever felt overwhelmed? Or like your life was so stress-filled and stressful that you couldn't even enjoy your life? What if I told you there is a little secret? There is something that the Jewish people have been doing for years and centuries. There's a discipline that is a regular part of their lives that has caused many of them to be able to steer clear of the stress-filled existence that many of us, you and me, often are accustomed to. I want to tell you about that secret.
We will always be drawn to overdo things, and God knows this. This is why He puts boundaries in place. They are a gift to us. We are now completely free, standing in the Shabbat space of God, the margin that God has given us so that we can experience the freedom that God has come to give all His children.
It's going to be a journey through the scriptures that is going to help us to enjoy life the way God always intended.
This five-week study is going to start October 12th. We do have books available for that. They'll be available next week. The books are going to be $15. It's just a study guide that you'll go with. And we will use the videos from Priscilla Shire. Awesome, awesome, awesome. I cannot wait to dig into this. And I can't wait for you guys to do that too. So we've got a flyer back there on the bulletin board about this. Please, let's all come together, ladies. Let's get together in this study here, and let's find out what the Word says about our busyness, and maybe God will kind of clear some things out with us for that time. So, if you got any questions, let me know, but we'll make the books available next week. We'll have those here.
Right. nothing else, I do want to announce Noisy Offering next Sunday, so please bring some change and money for that. And also, be in prayer for life tonight. We talked about a little bit in our Sunday school class this morning. It's a big thing we do on the Halloween, so make sure we're in prayer for that and get set up for the little fall festival, which is what we call it, fall festival now. All right, nothing else? All right, let's have ushers please come forward. I'm going to ask Brother Jerry Klein to have a prayer over offering.
God, Father, we know I come before you this morning, Father, with our minds and hearts and ready to receive your word, Father, with us. As we bring in this offering to you, Father, we just pray and give it to go to the building of your kingdom and that every cent will be used to in the way that you would have it to and according to your will. Continuous through this service. These things we pray in the name of Jesus.
Raise a day in the Oh,
sorrows erased. And when I stand before you, I'll find all along it was me on your mind. Who am I that the king of the world would give one single thought about my broken heart? Who am I that the God of all grace wipes the tears from my face and says, come as you are?
Glad that he did it all for you.
Amen.
For nobody else, he did it all for you.
Amen. Thank you.
That's how much he loves us.
Amen.
Maybe y'all got hope this morning.
And we just want to praise you for the mercy you've shown us, the forgiveness we have in Christ. Lord, this is a day that we celebrate that, Lord, and we praise you for it. God, I pray that you prepare our hearts right now to listen to the word that you give us, so that we might learn more about this grace and more about this mercy. And that, Lord, your Holy Spirit might be stirred within us today, God, that we might have a desire to go out and tell others about you, God. We know there are people in our lives that are lost, people that we know that have strayed from you, God, and we know that they need to come back. Father, I pray that you would use us, Lord, to reach out to people that need to know you, God, that need to know your Son, Jesus, and the free pardon of sin. God, I pray that you use us, Lord, by your Holy Spirit, draw people to the cross, Lord, so that their lives could be changed. Lord, change us, and then use us to change others. That's our prayer this morning, God. In the name of Jesus, amen. You guys can be seated.
He's been talking about sharing our story. We talked this morning in Sunday school with Paul, talking about we're not following Mark or another pastor, or Danny or Pat. You should be following Jesus.
That's right.
And Jesus, what he did for us is incredible. And, you know, if we're crucified with him and we live the rest of our lives for Christ, then folks will see Jesus in us, and they won't see Jad, they won't see Brian. They'll see Jesus, the one who can save their soul. That really touched me this morning with Sunday school class, and then we sang this song this morning in practice. We're going to sing it for you now. I hope that I'm always seen living a life that is crucified with Christ. Not I, but Christ who lives in me.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
I look back at what I thought was living. I'm amazed at the price I chose to pay. And to think I ignored what really mattered, 'cause I thought the sacrifice would be too great. When I finally reached the point of giving in, I found the cross was calling even then. Even though it took dying to survive, I never felt so much alive.
For
There's a sacrifice that's been made for you. And if you're not stepping out and trying to do something for God, you're not sacrificing. You're not sacrificing. It's going to cost you something.
That's right.
I'll tell you, the walking in the Christian walk, it's not an easy road, because you're going to be shunned. You're going to be turned away. You're going to be ridiculed because you're trying to do something for Christ. And that's where Satan rears his ugly head in your life. There is a sacrifice to being a Christian, and it's not going to be easy. But I got some good news. It's going to be worth
it.
That's right. It's going to be worth it, because one day we're going to leave this place, and I want to hear him say, "Well done. Well done, thou good and faithful servant." And when that happens, that's going to be worth every trial.
That's right.
It's going to be worth everything that you have endured, have gone through, because you're trying to take a stand for Christ. It's going to cost you something. But to have something like this, it's going to cost you something. He did that for us. Just think about that. If you have not sacrificed for him, that's what he wants from us.
Amen. Amen. Right. We're going to be have your Bible ready, and I guess Miss Becky, I failed again to give you any kind of direction. This is just to show you that it's not a predetermined thing, and she's magic back there because she's quick, and so she's shaking her head no. We'll see. Not too many scriptures today, but we've been talking about evangelism, we've been talking about outreach and that kind of thing, and the purpose of the church is to reach out to those that don't know Christ and to draw them into the cross. And that's what God is trying to do through each of us, through the church body, through the church as a whole, and the church universal. All those that follow Christ have the same purpose, and that's to draw people to the cross. And so that's what we're going to continue to talk about that. And the reason, okay, I'm tired of you preaching about this, preach about something else. Okay, I'm going to stop preaching about salvation, and I'm going to stop preaching about evangelism when there stops being a need for salvation. When you guys get out there and get everybody saved, I'll quit, okay? So that's not happened yet. I'm being funny, but you know, the need for salvation exists. And it exists in the lives of people that we know and we're in contact with every day. God wants to show his mercy to people, and he wants to do it through us. He wants to show his mercy to the lost, to people who have strayed, to people that are addicted, to people that are uncommitted, to people that live a life without purpose, people that don't even know who they are. We talked about it in Sunday school, how people don't have a sense of even who they are anymore, where they came from, because it's been taught that there is no God and there is no purpose and this is just a futile life. And how dull that would be, how depressing that would be. And that tells you why there's so many people that decide that, hey, it's not worth living anymore. There needs to be purpose in our life, and God has given us purpose. He's created us with purpose. Now, we're called as believers in Christ to walk with him, to tell the story of Christ, to tell our story. And that's what I'm going to be talking about here in a second here. But our compassion,
cannot fail. You know that God's mercy never fails. It's new every morning, the Bible says. His compassion and His mercy and His grace, it never fails us. Our compassion for others has to be on par with that of God. We have to strive to attain that. And so we have to maintain this compassion for people, even when they ignore God and when they ignore the church and they ignore any sort of effort you might make to tell them about Christ. We've got to still have compassion for them. And we've been talking about outreach and telling our story, and we've been persistent about it. I talked about persistent outreach last week. We have to be persistent. Aren't you glad that God hasn't given up on you? And aren't you glad that when you stray, that God comes looking for you? It's almost like He did that kind of thing with us on His mind, right? Somebody wrote a song about that. So aren't you glad that it's that way with God? We need to treat others like that. We've been given this wonderful gift of salvation. We know the truth about Christ, and we've got to begin to share that in a deeper and more meaningful way. Last week, we talked about, I asked the question, what does your story sound like? We talked about telling your story, and I gave you four examples. I'm going to go through them real quick. The woman at the well. She was born to the wrong family. She's an outcast, a half-breed. You can call all sorts of names, and she was an adulteress. She'd had five husbands, and now the man she was living with was not her husband at all, and Jesus knew that. And you know what her story would have been if it was just one sentence? Perhaps. He knows everything I've ever done, yet He still loves me. Yes. That would be her testimony. That would be her story. Your story doesn't have to be complicated. It can be as simple as that. And the people that knew her and what kind of person she was, I'm sure they saw a change in her. In Mark chapter 1, the second example was the leper that was healed. And Jesus came in and healed the leper, and He said, don't tell anybody that it was me that healed you. I think that was a reverse psychology thing He was doing. You know how we are? You know, we instead of telling our kids to do good things, we tell them, you can do anything you want, but don't do this one thing. You know, it didn't work with God with Adam and Eve in the garden, and it doesn't work with our kids either, you know. So you tell them not to do something, that's the thing I'm going to do first, right? He told the leper that he'd healed, He said, don't tell anybody. And what did the leper do? It's Mark chapter 1, verse 45. It says, he went out and began immediately to proclaim it freely. You know, so he didn't do what Jesus told him, but it was because he had such a burning testimony. He was a leper. He was separated from his family, separated from church. You know, he couldn't go into the temple or the synagogue because he was unclean. He was completely separated from everyone, separated from God as well, and that's what this represents, right? And so God, when He healed him, He reconciled him to his family and to society and to the church and to himself. And so he had an amazing story, and his testimony would be, look, I got to tell you what God did for me because it was amazing. That would be his story. Acts chapter 9. There's actually only three examples. I guess I could give you another one, but it was only three. Acts chapter 9 is the last one. It's Paul. Remember Paul on the road to, Saul on the road to Damascus? His change was so incredible, they changed his name too. They called him something else. Didn't want to get him mixed up with the old guy. I think when we get saved, we should change names. That would probably be better. So, Saul encountered Christ on the road to Damascus. Saul was imprisoning Christians because they were counted as heretics. They were departing from the Jewish faith and following Christ, and they were criminals in the eyes of the church. And he was given approval by the church to go and drag them back to prison and toss them in prison and let them die there. You know, and that was what Saul was all about. And when he met Jesus, things changed. He was completely transformed. He went from inflicting pain, and I talked about last week, inflicting suffering, to willingly bearing suffering for the name of Christ. And I gave the list of all the times that he was beaten with rods and left for dead and shipwrecked and all that kind of thing. Paul said, hey, it's great. Bring it on, because I'm willing to suffer anything for Christ. It's kind of like that other song we sang, Crucified with Christ. And Paul said that in Galatians 2:20. We found out this morning. So here's the example of Paul. And his story might be, look, I fought with God all my life. I fought against Him all my life, but I met Jesus. And now I'm fighting for Him. And my life has completely changed. And that might be his testimony. So these stories, They don't have to be elaborate. They don't have to be just some incredible earth-shaking thing. Just the simple thing of you being saved and having eternal life and having peace with God. That's enough to tell others about. So it doesn't matter where you fall into the category of what kind of story do you have. Everybody has a story. And I asked the question last week, what does your story sound like? To get you thinking about that. What's my story? So this week I promised you last week, you may not remember the promise, but I do. I said, I'm going to tell you what your story could possibly sound like. We're going to talk about what the story sounds like. And then I told you last week, I said next week we're going to talk about how to tell your story. So that's what we're going to talk about. How to tell your story, okay? So I'm going to give you four pointers, I guess, or four things that you can do and you can remember to know how to tell your story effectively. Okay, everybody ready for that?
Yes.
Okay, if I tell you these things, will you use it?
Yes.
Okay, everybody's shaking their head. I saw everybody shake their head, so it's good. So the first thing you need to do in telling your story, you need to remember this. Only tell what you know. If you were being brought up in court as a witness, you saw a crime committed or you saw an automobile accident out on the road in front of the church, you know, and you're going to be a witness, you know what they ask you? What did you see? On the morning of the 19th, what did you see? You know, like the cop shows do. And so you would say, tell what you saw. They're not asking for your opinion necessarily. They're not maybe asking you to specify guilt or innocence and all. They just want to know what you saw. And sometimes that's all we can tell. We just have to tell what we know. What happened to us? I don't know about anybody else, but this is what happened to me. We all have that story if we're saved. Amen? And so we can tell our story. We can tell what happened to us in a lot of different ways. The first one is to give Him praise. Psalm 105 verses 1 and 2. We know that every good gift comes from God, right? Every good thing we have, we ought to be thankful for. Psalms 105 verses 1 and 2 says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon His name," and listen to this, "make known His deeds among the people." Now, if you can think over the last week, has anything good happened to me that I can attribute to God? Has there been anything at all? And if there has, you know that's something you can tell other people about. And in doing that, you're telling part of your story. Look what God did for me. You're not bragging, except bragging on God, right? God, this happened in my life last week, and I just have to stop and say, thank God, I know it came from you. That's giving glory to God, and it's telling part of your story. And that's easy, isn't it? So give Him praise. How about tell how God delivered you through a crisis? If you remember the story of the three Hebrew children in the fiery furnace, Daniel chapter 3, I'll just give you a synopsis of it, like four statements here. So they were captives in Babylon, you know, and Nebuchadnezzar was the king, and he was all into himself really hard, really bad. He was worshiping other gods, so they had idols that were not the true and living God that the Hebrews served. So they had idols, and he also erected this statue of himself. Now, I had thought about doing that at the church, but I didn't think it would be of much value to anybody, not even to me, because I don't like to look at myself in the mirror, so the statue would be overkill. But what happened was, he commanded everybody that was under his rule, he said, when you hear the trumpets blow, you're going to bow down to those gods, and you're going to bow down to this statue of me. And the three Hebrew children wouldn't do it. The trumpets blew, and they didn't bow down, and somebody told on them. And Nebuchadnezzar goes to them and says, is it true? Did you not bow down? And they said, not only did we not bow down then, we're not going to bow down. He really liked that. And he got really angry, the Bible says, and he said, heat the fiery furnace up seven times hotter than it's ever been, and they bound up the three Hebrew children. They had their coats and their hats on. I don't know what detail there was in that and why it was there necessarily, but they just, as they stood, they just wrapped them all together, and the furnace was so hot, the Bible says, that the men that threw them into the furnace, they died from the intense heat. And then Nebuchadnezzar, he's leaning over, he's looking down in the furnace saying, this will teach you. And he said, wait a second. I thought we threw three in there. There's four. And the one that I see that's kind of out, and they're all in there walking around, by the way. He said, the fourth one looks like the Son of God. It's amazing. I don't know if you've ever been thrown into a furnace. But have you? Have you been in an intense situation where you said, your heart fell to your stomach?
said, God, I can't do this. I don't know how this is going to turn out. Lord, you've got to save me. The three Hebrew children, even before they were thrown in, you know what they said? They said, it's okay. If we burn up, that's fine. But we got a God that can deliver us. If he decides not to, that's good. But we're still going to obey God. When we're in a mess and we're in over our head, and however you want to describe the trouble that we can get ourselves into, whether it's our fault or not, when we can't do anything about it, God is there with us. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. And when we depend on him and he gets us through that trouble, what a testimony. Let me tell you this part of my story. I was in this situation and it was impossible. There's absolutely no way this was going to work out right, but God was with me. You know, I still have that problem and I haven't overcome it yet and I'm still right in the middle of it, but I know that God is with me and it's okay. So you can tell part of your story by telling about something God has delivered you from. And then you can let people see the difference in your life. Let people see that you are different in the way you approach life and your perspective on life. In John chapter 9, one of my favorite stories in the Bible, I know I say it all the time, one of my favorite stories in the Bible is where Jesus, it's a good story, Jesus heals the man that was born blind. And this is where he spits in the clay and makes, you know, or spits in the dirt, makes clay, and he puts it on ice to go wash in the pool of Siloam. And he comes back and he's seeing. And he comes back and there's all these questions everybody's asking him. I'm just a blind guy that got healed by Jesus. Why are you asking all these questions? And here's the questions. I think they're cool. To his family and friends, people that knew him ever since he was a little kid, is it really you? You know? There's something different about you. He said, yeah, I can see. But yeah, it's really me. He could answer that question because that's something he knew, right? He said, they asked him, how were your eyes open? He said, I don't know how he did it, but it was Jesus that did it. And they asked him some more questions, but I want to move on. So he was brought before the council. And this is the cool part. So he's brought before the council because they don't trust Jesus and they don't think he's a God man. They think he's part of the legion of the devil or whatever. And so they brought him before the council. They're asking him all these questions. He says, what do you think about this man, Jesus? Is he a sinner? They said, we know he's a sinner, so you need to agree with us. And that's basically what they were saying. And the man said, I don't know about that. All I know is that once I was blind and now I see. That's something he knew. And that's all he had to say. And so it's interesting when they ask these questions. People saw a difference in his life. It was impactful enough that all he had to tell was just the little pieces he knew. Does anybody know how salvation occurs? I mean, we know the Roman road and we know all that. How does God make that change in us? I don't know all the details, but I can tell what I know. Mm-hmm. Amen? Mm-hmm. Are you saved this morning? Mm-hmm. Then you've got a story to tell. And it's your story. And you can tell. You don't have to give a big flowery explanation. It doesn't have to be anything great. It can just be what God has done for you. So the first thing is tell what you know. The second thing is cast your net on the right side. Cast your net on the right side. Fishing is hard work. There's a lot of stuff you have to do with the nets to make them correctly and keep them clean and keep them mended and all that, because they fish with nets, not with rod and reel and all that stuff like we do. There's a lot of hard work rowing the boat. When you get in the elements and you're dependent on the elements, you don't know what's going to happen, so you've got to be prepared, and it's difficult work. And when the storm comes, some of them are rowing and some are bailing, and they swap up, and this guy bails and this guy rows, and all that's going on while they're trying to fish and trying to survive even, right? All of this is hard work. Fishermen's hands get dirty and their clothes get smelly and they got calluses and blisters and all that stuff. It's a messy affair to go fishing. And so in John 21, Peter said, this is after the resurrection of Christ, Peter said, I'm going to go fishing. They said, we're going to go fishing with you. This is the people that were in the upper room, the apostles, I would assume. And so, because a lot of them were already fishermen by trade, right? So they get in the boat, and these disciple, apostle fishermen, they thought they knew where the fish were and how to catch them. But on that particular night, the Bible says they caught nothing. But we've been fishing all night long. So as a fisherman, and maybe you can answer this later, maybe it's a long discussion. If it is, we'll just talk about it later, Randy. But if you're a fisherman, when do you know when to stop fishing? If you're not catching anything and not even getting a bite, how long do you go without catching anything? These guys went all night. I don't know if that's how you guys are. I think I would have quit before that. Maybe tried another day. These guys thought they knew what they were doing. Where the fish were, how to cast them, all these things. But here's Jesus. He appears on the shore. It's interesting because he's already cooking some fish. So he's already successful at fishing. He's a pretty good fisherman. You know, by the way, I was reading about fishermen in the Bible, and I was reminded of that story when they were talking about, do you pay taxes to Caesar and all that kind, and why doesn't your master pay the tax and all that? And he tells Peter, he said, go, you know, throw a hook out in there, and the first fish you come up, open his mouth, there's going to be a coin in there, go pay our taxes. That's how good a fisherman he is, right? He can just cause a fish to come to you. So it's kind of interesting when you start looking at it. But in this story, Jesus is already on the shore, he's catching fish, he's the resurrected Christ, and he hollers out, knowing the answer already. He said, have you caught anything? And they said, not anything. He said, cast your net on the right side of the boat. And I've always thought, if I were those fishermen, I'd have been so frustrated at that comment. Do you think we didn't cast on the right side? Are you crazy? I've already thought of that. We've done it 100 times. But you know what they did? They cast their net on the right side of the boat. And it says they caught so many fish, they could just barely get them to shore. They struggled to get them to shore. It's an amazing thing. Hadn't caught anything all night, then they all seemed to swim into that all at one time. And of course, they knew it was Jesus. So that's the story. But this applies to us. Now, we're not fishermen. We're not going out with nets trying to catch fish and that kind of thing. But in the same way, we've got to follow God's direction. We've got to cast our nets on the right, the correct side of the boat. We've got to do things the right way, God's way, when we're talking about outreach and evangelism, right? When we're telling our story, we've got to do it the right way. We may think we know where the fish are. Oh yeah, you got to go to where the fish are. Well, do you really know where the fish are? Well, we think we do, and we'll go there, and we'll put our effort in. We may know where lost people are. God knows which lost people are ready to be saved. Amen? We may really think we've got it down pat. We know how to weave a strong net. And that strong, you know, you think about telling your story. I'm going to make my story sound amazing so it really draws people in. You know, and we've got this net that we throw out to get people into this amazing story that I've kind of embellished here and there so it's a little bit more interesting. We may know how to weave a strong net, but John 6:44, Jesus says that no man can come to Christ except the Holy Spirit draw him. If we're trying to make our story sound amazing, we need to realize that it already is and let the Holy Spirit do his job of drawing people through us. Amen? Doesn't matter how much effort or work we put in, if we're not casting our net on the right side of the boat, unless the Holy Spirit is not involved in the witnessing and in the telling of our story, nothing's going to happen. And we can fish all night and never catch a single fish. We can tell our story 1,000 times and it not be effective if we're not doing it under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. Amen?
Right.
Amen. We got to cast our net on the right side of the boat. So the first one is tell what you know. Second one's cast your net on the right side of the boat. The third one is pray for opportunity. Now, if you're following the Holy Spirit, if you're led by the Holy Spirit, you're following His leadership, you are going to be led into opportunities where you can witness to people. It will happen. But I want to point something out. There is scriptural basis, scriptural direction that kind of leads us to pray for opportunity. Not just, hey, Lord, whatever happens today, I'm open. So just, you know, whatever. No, there's opportunity that we should be praying for. God, give me the opportunity to witness. Give me the opportunity, Lord, to tell my story today. Send somebody my way. Send me their way so that our paths can cross and I can tell somebody my story. Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 through 5. Great scripture right here. Paul is giving general direction for the church, general instructions for the church. And he says this, continue earnestly in prayer. Be vigilant in it with thanksgiving. Meanwhile, listen to this, praying also for us. And he's talking about those that are in the ministry, so to speak, and those that are traveling and planting churches. That he's talking about him and the folks working with him. Pray for us that God would open to us a door for the word. Paul said, I want you to help us pray that God will give us the place to go and tell others for Christ, that he'll lead us into the right places. He was saying, in essence, pray for opportunity for us. That God would open us a door for the word to speak the mystery of Christ for which I am in chains, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. And so you look at it. At first he says, pray with thanksgiving. And he says, oh, by the way, while you're praying, pray for us. So it flips from us to him and now back from him to us. Because look at the last verse there. Verse 5 and 6, the last two verses. Then it goes back to the church member, back to us. Walk in wisdom toward those who are outside, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt. Listen, that you may know how you ought to answer each one, so that you might know how to respond to people who don't know Christ or people that have questions about Christ. So the concept is there in that verse, and I don't believe I'm stretching it too far here to say we should be praying for opportunities to witness to people. We should have enough compassion about people that we have a desire. He says, redeem the time. That means the time is short. You need to be witnessing. You need to be telling your story. You need to pray for opportunity. The concept is right there in these verses. Paul is saying, be ready, be prepared to give an answer, to be prepared to tell your story. And then he's saying, pray for opportunity to tell your story. So, tell what you know is the first one. Cast your net on the right side of the boat and then pray for opportunity. And the last one is this. You need to pray that you would recognize opportunity and respond with boldness and passion. Pray that you be able to see the opportunity as it presents itself, opportunity to witness, and respond to that opportunity with boldness and passion. So we should be praying in James, the first chapter. It says, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men liberally and upbraideth not, or doesn't have any kind of distinction between people. He said, and let him ask in faith, and he'll receive the wisdom from God. And so we should pray for wisdom and discernment so that our eyes can see the opportunity. How many opportunities, I'm going to ask you a question. This would be a good question like this. How many opportunities have passed you by unnoticed? Does anybody know? No, you don't, because they passed you by unnoticed. So how many have we missed? We don't know. If we were to look back and we could actually see it, we might be amazed how many times somebody's right in front of us and we're too busy thinking about other things. We don't even think about witnessing. And I know we got stuff to do. Everybody's busy. I get that. I'm busy too. But we got to recognize opportunities and take advantage of them, right? So we pray for wisdom and discernment so we'll see the opportunity. And you think about it. The preparation has been done. We've been talking about it in these verses. We've been working here at the church, preparing ourselves to be ready to give an answer for the hope that's within us with meekness and godly fear and that kind of thing, right? And so preparation has been done. We've been praying for opportunities. If we followed that's number three, right? So God's timing is perfect. And so now, here we are at this last one. God's timing is perfect, and we suddenly, we've been praying for opportunities, we're prepared, we're ready, and suddenly we see a door opening and an opportunity beginning to reveal itself. We have to respond with boldness and passion. If you see the opportunity, you recognize it, and don't respond to it with boldness and passion, you don't respond at all, that's a lost opportunity. So, since God's timing is perfect,
and he makes no mistakes and there are no coincidences. And he wants us to be ready to tell our story, and he wants us to be praying for opportunity. When the opportunity presents itself, you know what he wants us to do? When the door opens, walk through it. When God gives you opportunity, he wants you to take advantage of it, because somebody needs to hear your story, right? And so, in Acts 4:13, this is part of the story of the lame man that was healed, I think, right? You guys look that up and let me know. I think it's the story of the lame man that Peter and John are going to the temple, you know, and the man is lame, and he's been lame since birth, and he holds up his cup, and Peter says, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give to thee. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise and walk." And he walks, and it says they go into the temple with him, and he's jumping around, and it's an amazing thing, right? And so they call them before the council because they did such an amazing thing. Okay, sounds like today, right? Get in trouble for doing the right thing. So Acts 4:13, it's interesting when they're called before the council. And this is why I talk about boldness. This is what it says. In Acts 4:13, not going to read the verse, I'll just tell you what it says. Acts 4:13, it says the council, when they had questioned them and Peter and John responded, it says they saw their boldness and they knew they'd been with Jesus. Because being with Jesus, a little boldness will rub off on you, right? And so he saw their boldness, they realized they'd been with Jesus. In Acts 4:20, around that area, the council told them to, okay, you guys step out, we're going to talk about this and figure out what we're going to do with y'all. They were from the south. They said, "Y'all." And so they came back in and said, "This is what we're going to do. We're going to let you go if you promise not to ever speak the name of Jesus again or teach anything about him or do anything in his name. If you'll do that, we're going to let you go." And do you remember what Peter said? He said, "I think it's probably a little bit more important for us to obey God rather than you. No offense, but God's a little bit more important than you." And they said, "We're not, yeah, we're going to keep preaching. It's okay." Right? And so that's what they said in like verse 20. Verse 29, so they go back, they get released anyway. I think, did they beat them that time? I think they maybe punished them and that kind of thing. So they send them back, and they go back to where all the other disciples are, and they meet with them, and they tell them how wonderful it was to be able to suffer on behalf of Christ. And then they start praying. And what did they pray for? They pray for boldness. Look at Acts 4:29. It says, "Now, Lord, look upon their threats, and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word." We can take that same verse and we can apply it to our lives. Lord, I just pray that with all boldness I'll be able to tell my story, to tell others about Christ, to speak your word. We need boldness. And so I'm going to kind of close with this, but I'm going to close with a couple of questions. Are we passionate about Jesus? Now, we've talked about the four things. Tell what you know, cast your net on the right side, pray for opportunity, and then respond, be able to recognize the opportunity and respond with boldness and passion. We talked about boldness. Let's talk about passion for a second. We are passionate about a lot of things. I bet I don't know, but I would bet you that there are a lot of people that were passionate yesterday afternoon, around 5 o'clock-ish. There's some sort of event that went on that had 100,000 people all in one place with one mind and one accord. Almost sounds like the Bible, and it can be a religion if we just let it go too far here. But I would say that most of the people, if not all, were very passionate yesterday. And so we're passionate about a lot of things, but are we passionate about Christ? Why talk about passion when it comes to Jesus Christ? Well, your encounter with Christ on the day of your salvation should be the most important event in your life and the most amazing thing that's ever happened to you. If it's not, you need to step back and look at your life and see that you're going the wrong direction. Something's wrong. If that's not the most important day of your life, if that's not the thing, if you were brought up and you were interviewed by Channel 5 or whatever channel you listen to and that kind of thing, and they said, "Hey, we just are going around and we're stopping people on the street and we're asking them what's the most significant thing that ever happened in your life," it ought to immediately be, "I got saved when I was 9 years old and my life has never been the same. You need Jesus. Do you know Jesus?" And we automatically, you know, they're going to cut that one out most likely.
And you still got to say it, don't you? It shouldn't be anything other than that if you're saved. Isn't that right? And so are we passionate about that? You know, you think about it, God has forgotten our past. He's promised and has come, he's good on that promise. He's promised to walk with us in the present, and then he's building a future for us that's eternal and amazing, and we don't even have the brain to be able to understand it at this point. That ought to make us passionate, right? What about how he's changed who we were? How many of you, don't raise your hand, just think about it. Don't embarrass anybody. How many of you lived a really bad life? And, how many of you know, especially if you're saved later in life, I guess, that you were going the wrong direction and your life is a mess and there's so many things, you wish you could forget stuff. But you can't even forget all the ugly things that went on in your life. But suddenly you met Christ and your life was changed. If your life has been transformed, and he's taken who you were and erased that, and now you're a different person, and he's created a new person in Christ. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that something to be passionate about? God is changing us into the person he sees in us. Sometimes, Pat, I don't know what God sees in me. Because not any prettiness in there, you know. Got the old bowed leg, my joints are getting sore. Something having to do with age. I don't know. Some of you older folks can tell me about it. So what is it that he sees in me? I make a mess of so many things. What is it that he sees in me? I wonder what I'm going to become. But I know that God is working on me. And that's an amazing thing. And so we got to be passionate about Christ. And you know, God is blessing us. Can everybody raise, are you blessed? Is God bless you? Okay, I want you to stop thinking about stuff then. Start thinking about it in your spiritual life. Has God blessed you? Amen. He's blessed us. We have salvation. We have this relationship with God. That's amazing. That's enough to be passionate. Why are we not passionate about Christ? We've got to pray for that as well. And so, having asked that, the greatest blessing we can give anybody, you know, there's plenty of people that need help, and we can give people food and all, and we ought to do those things. We can pay their light bill. We can do all those things. The best thing we can do is tell them about Christ and just be honest with them and tell them the truth. And give them the opportunity to receive Christ. So, second question, and this is going to be the last one. What does your witnessing life look like? We talked about last week, what does your story look like? What does your witnessing life look like? Do you realize you've got a story? And you're telling your story already by the way you live and your attitudes and your words and that kind of thing. But are you trying to do things God's way? Are you really reaching out and trying to cast your net on the right side of the boat? Are you trying to do what God says and do it His way? Is that what your life looks like? Are you praying for opportunities to witness, and you've got a desire to serve God, and you have compassion for the lost? Are you taking advantage of the opportunities you have to witness? All those are great questions. What are you doing in your life to serve God? Are you telling your story? Anybody think that's important? You know why you're saved? Because somebody told their story. Somebody told you about Jesus. You know why you've matured and grown in Christ? Because somebody came along with you and said, I've been through that very thing, and it's going to be okay. That's why you haven't given up yet. All those things that you've experienced, they've made up this wonderful story of your life that you can share with somebody else. And I just want to challenge you. If we can just become passionate about who Christ is and what He's done for us, and if we can become passionate about telling others about Christ before it's too late, I think we'll see a change. There'll be a change in us if that's what our focus becomes. And I gotta tell you, I'm as guilty as anybody. I get busy. Y'all may be busier than me, or I may be busier. You know, none of that is a reason for us to not tell our story. You know, if you're out and you're running around and you're with people all the time and you're just overwhelmed with the stuff you're gonna do, you know what would make it worthwhile? Tell somebody, every time you stop somewhere, make it a point to tell somebody about Jesus. Ask them if they're saved. You know, our credit card got hacked. And somebody charged some stuff on our card that
We didn't charge it, right? Somebody from California, I think. And so I was on the phone with credit card. Hey, these are not our charges. And they said, okay, we'll take care of it. I said, well, what are you going to do? And they said, well, we just cut your credit card off. Okay. We use it a lot, you know. And so we're going to send you another one in a couple weeks. And I'm thinking, what? So I actually had to take cash to the gas station and buy gas with cash. That was weird. I haven't done that in 25 years, probably. And we get dependent on those things, and, you know, that would have been a great conversation starter, wouldn't it? You know? Hey, you'll never believe what happened. Yeah, I'm paying with you with cash because my credit card got out. Hey, do you know Jesus? That's probably not a real good segue. But you understand that every event that happens to us happens for a reason. And God is creating opportunities for us to run into people that we would not normally see. And that's the point of the story. I saw a guy that I had never seen before in my life. And I might not ever see him again. And granted, that might mean that I don't get to tell him about Jesus now because I didn't tell him that day. Not too worried about my credit card and cash. How do I do this? God is simply asking us to tell our story. And what an amazing story we have to tell, every one of us. I'm going to ask you, where are you in your relationship with God? And are you really focused on telling your story and serving God by telling others about Christ? Maybe you're separated from God by your busyness, or maybe some other things in your life are going in such a direction that you're just distracted by everything. I think God is calling the church back to doing the simple things again, telling others what God has done for you. It ought to be an everyday thing. I'm trying to get to that place. You know, you can't go into every business setting and talk about Jesus. You know that? You could get in trouble. But you know, when somebody says something that remotely, it's like one of those algorithms that chooses those keywords. You know, when I hear that key word and somebody says, it's a real blessing, boy, okay, I can go now. I have permission. We went to church, so I said, okay, I'm there. I'm in the conversation. We pass up so many opportunities to tell others about Christ, to tell our story, to give people strength and to give them comfort, to encourage them. We've got to do that every day. What if today's my last day? What if today's the last time I see that guy at the gas station? I hope he's watching. I apologize for not telling you, not asking you if you're saved. Not being sincere. I should have asked him. Are you witnessing to people? Are you asking about Jesus? If they know him, are you telling your story? Would you stand with me? That's exactly what God is calling us to tell others about Christ. Okay, Brother Mark, another sermon about witnessing. Got it. It's like I told you, I quit preaching about this when everybody gets saved. Or when the rapture happens. Whichever comes first. Let's bow our heads together. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. And we just want to praise you and thank you for the merciful and forgiving God that you are. We want to thank you for loving us when we are completely and totally unlovable. I want to thank you, God, that forgiveness is there for us, even when we knowingly do what's wrong. God, we're so rebellious. We get so distracted by things. But God, I thank you that you're still a forgiving God. You're faithful to us, even when we're not faithful to you. And so, God, I ask you to forgive us for keeping the most important thing that's ever happened to us, from keeping the story of Christ to ourselves the way that we do. Father, we repent of that this morning, God, as a church. I repent of it myself personally, God. And I pray for those opportunities to be created in my life, opportunities to tell my story. Lord, I pray for that wisdom that I need to recognize the opportunity, and then I pray for boldness from the Holy Spirit, knowing that I may not have it within myself, but the Holy Spirit in me can move me to speak with great power and with wisdom. And God, I certainly don't have that in myself. I need you, Lord. Make me bold to witness for Christ. Lord, help us to redeem the time.
never pass up an opportunity, God. Change us. Make us more effective in the way that we witness, God. Thank you for saving me when I was 9 years old. I reaffirm, God, that that's the most amazing thing that ever happened in my life, because I know it changed the very course of my life. It changed my eternity. I praise you for who you are, what you're doing in my life. I pray that you draw us all closer to you. Draw us back to you, Father. And then send us out in the world empowered to reach people for Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. If you've got a need in your life, you come. We'll pray.
Take away the melody. Take away the songs I sing. Take away all the lies. All the songs you let me write. Doesn't matter.
John Brown and I worked together at Gates Rubber Company. We farmed and hunted together. Brother Jimmy Anderson lost his daughter, and he's in bad shape. Randy Andrews is in real bad shape. He went to the doctor, and they found out they had to take him in and operate on him. He had an intestine twisted. And I have a grandson that lost his grandmother this week, Justin, and went to Hunter. you know. And so a lot of things going on there, you know. So, but I thank God I'm still able to kind of get around, still put on your hair a little while.
Yes.
She lay a sick on me all the time.
We're glad you're fussing on her too.
Yeah.
She needs that.
I hope that people hope to see Jesus in me.
Yes, ma'am.
I hope that my walk in this life right now, that people will know that,
yes, ma'am,
I love Jesus and
yes,
I'm
ma'am
living for him.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I've seen that up there, and if you feel a little boy, his name was Cody. Now, the pastor at Springfield, seen him come up and do it. He's like me, he couldn't sing, but he's like, he'd get up there and he said, I want the people to see Jesus in me.
Yes.
And I've seen that about that song yet.
Yes.
I thought about Cody there, you know, yes, and about he wanted to see people. What a good testimony that is.
Yes, sir. Who else?
You know, Brother Harper had mentioned about Brother Anderson. It's Trisha Creasy's sister that passed away on Thursday. They were having her funeral service yesterday, and yesterday morning Brother Anderson died. Trisha's dad died as well yesterday morning. So she's lost a sister and a dad in 2 days. So let's pray for them, because I know they're going through a hard time today. Got a lot of days ahead, so let's pray for them.
You feel like Brother Jimmy died?
Yes, sir. He did. Saturday morning, I think.
I know that they put a valve in his heart, and then he fell, and they thought he was going to be paralyzed, but I didn't know he passed away.
Yes, sir.
I know his daughter was very serious.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure did.
I mean, he'll go back a long way.
Yeah. He's a good fellow. Sure. Anybody else, real quick? Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Praise Jesus for bringing my dad to another.
In just a few weeks, we're going to have an opportunity to share our story and witness to people. And the Light the Night that's across the way is going to be on Monday night, October 31st. There's things in place getting ready for that. Brandon wanted me to announce that if you would like to bring some wrapped candy for that event, so for our Halloween bags or Light the Night bags. Also, we're getting together a chili and soup cook-off. So be thinking about that, so that way you can plan to make your chili or plan to make your soup, and we're going to give away a gift card for the best voted on soup or chili. But there's going to be a lot of things going on. If you don't want to buy candies or anything and you want to just give some money, just give Brandon or Jenna some money and they'll pick up the candies for you. And we're in the process of getting all that together. And after tonight, we're going to be using our Sunday night outreaches getting ready for Light the Night.
Yep.
So we're going to be finding out ways that we can be telling other people about this event.
Yeah. Awesome. Well done. All right. I want you to do one more thing, and we'll dismiss with this. Look around you to the left or right, and is there somebody that normally sits with you that's not here? Is there anybody that's not here that's sitting with you? Okay, y'all pay attention. That's great. If you notice that somebody is missing, please give them a call. Just say, hey, I missed you today. I looked around. I didn't see you. Just want to make sure you're okay. And just let them know that you care about them. We need to be doing that for each other, to encourage each other so that we can be encouraged when we go out in the world and we face all things we have to face, and we tell our story to maybe, hopefully, Holy Spirit work through with us and draw them to Christ. So just reach out to somebody that's missing that, all right? We're going to bow our heads in prayer, and I'm going to ask Brother Speed to lead us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for having a great service this morning, a great time to speak to you, so we can be grateful for all of it. Heavenly Father, all these praises we've heard tonight, we know that anything you can do, Father. And we know all these different other situations that are going on. You know the best course of action here, Father, for everyone involved. We just lift this up to you and all these different needs and this request, Father. Be with all the ones that lost loved ones, comfort them, and let them know. Feel your peace that you have. Go with us in this week, that we can be a better Christian life for you and in the places that we go.
forth, that